Hey guys.
Hey, Gish. Had me worried there for a minute.
Hi, Yogesh. Hi, all.
It's so cool seeing you after a long time. How are you doing?
Yes, fine. And thank you. How are you also? Nice.
Good.
Good.
Mark, ready for 6 months of sunny afternoons in Houston?
Yeah. No, I'm not sure that I would state it just that way. It would be more like, are you ready for the blistering heat for the next 6 months?
Hey, Mita.
Hi, everyone.
So, I mean, while we are waiting, where are we, and what do you think when we will be able to go through the list of, I guess, the critical configuration cases, or how we want to?
Yeah. Well, I was, where are we? We hopefully just, finished the complete abort, but really wasn't a complete abort discussion. It was meant to talk about DPC and the complexities of it, and to drive home the point of what you just asked, what should the settings be? And been trying to say that it's not an easy topic because it depends on things like, do you have a switch involved? And do you want to enable DPC or not? Because that will highly affect what the default settings should be. So originally when we started this, we had a whole bunch of columns, not just root port behavior. We had said, okay, what happened? You said the root port, downstream port, the switches at the endpoint, and what happens if you have DPC and enable or disable? It was kind of to highlight that it's not going to be as clear. So the answer to your question is, if we want to do this, it'd be difficult to make something that will work for everybody. But hopefully we give and maybe we could try to create a standard default settings for all, for a list of standard configurations. But the point to drive home is that you have to know your platform very well.
Yeah, I mean, I don't expect us to have full, all the combinations that are possible for variety of, including variety of deployment models. I think the idea here would be to hit upon the common deployment models for OEMs, major CSPs. We have had those also highlighted, like in our at a different level in our hardware fault management framework, and maybe we can add some more PCI specific nuances and go with that. I don't think it would be wise to try to cover all different possibilities. That's just too many. So
Yeah,
hey, Yeah,
I was going to say, I agree, but it seems like there'll be some settings where it's just, here's the trade-off. You do this if you want this, do that if you want that, and we're done. And then in some cases, it's going to be like, hey, advisory non-failures are really confusing. Can we do something in the background through PCIe SIG, going through their official process to clear it up? We just have to survey all of them and figure out the best we can do it. But we'll be better off for this than we were before it.
I think the example you just mentioned is, if you can get something out of that, right? At that in the can we please improve advisory non-fatal? That's not something we discuss in this forum, but something we agree that it will put pressure on with our PCIe SIG representatives on an architectural design that actually works would benefit us in
Hey, Evan, sorry to interrupt. Are you sharing something?
I'm not sharing anything. Do you want me to?
Are you discussing on the previous where we left it last time?
No, Anil, we're just having a general discussion about, we have been talking about this PCIe cases, error types and configuration use cases for a while now. And we're just trying to get a sense of which ones we need to cover, how long will probably take. Just a general discussion, nothing specific right now.
Well, let's
While
just
we're
keep working
waiting.
on it until we cover all
Yeah.
the
No,
error types.
we're not we're not changing anything. I'm just
Yeah.
kind of getting a sense of how many we haven't really prioritized. I was talking to Erwin if he has a sense of how many critical high impacting kind of scenarios that we have identified, or he has identified. We did not discuss that. But anyway, moving on. Let's start today's meeting. Are there any opens today?
So I just want to call out, I've invited Bill from Meta to join this meeting. He is one
Hey,
of our
Bill.
experts in the PCIe
Hello.
domain.
Welcome.
Yeah, thanks. I guess I should show my face, huh? Yeah, I'll just be listening. See if I can
Great to
catch
have
up to
you.
what's up.
All right. Anil, did you ask to discuss about the regional conference a couple of meetings ago? So we can probably leave the last 15 minutes for that, if that's what you wanted.
Sure. I think, yeah. If you give me 15 minutes, I can walk through
Okay.
the content.
All right. So let's, any other opens? If not, we can get started.
Okay. So I think hopefully we wanted to close on DPC, right? I know originally why sent, hey, some of these values, like, why do you want to have DPC respond with a computer board? I think I forgot what the other one was. Think we're clear on DPC, right? And computer board. And like this was the suggested value that I was saying, that let's use completer board as a means to signal that a DPC occurred, because UR is just way overloaded right now.
Yeah, that makes sense. Arvind, I think I like your recommendation, and unfortunately, that's not what we implemented. But we are going to take this recommendation and drive some decisions
Yeah.
in the future.
And then a few things that came out of that, I think Vilas was said that he's going to go to the SIG and clarify the SFW. Because that's really not clear on what's supposed to happen. And if it's not clear, I don't think anybody's going to do anything. Or you're going to get
That's
mixed
kind of
behaviors.
unfortunate. That's unfortunate that the spec is spec calls out, but nobody paid attention to that.
Arvind, remind me, what was SFW? I'm not here.
This note here on 25. So there's a we it basically enhanced error correctable messages to add a message payload, and that message payload will tell you whether or not it was due to SFI or DPC. And or it was due to a AER error correctable, because error correctable is used for both, right?
What's SFI?
Good question. I'm not entirely sure what it is. I'm trying to find my notes on what I put SFI is, but it's in the PCIe spec.
It is defined in the spec. Let's
Yeah,
put it
it's a
this way.
capability in the spec.
What section number you're looking at, Irwin? 6.2, right?
No, there's been the
Yeah, it's a six.
capability would be in chapter 7.
Chapter
Oh yeah,
seven.
6.2 version, if that's what you mean.
Do you have any table number or anything for me?
Yeah, let me see.
I can open it and yeah. I'm also looking for it.
System firmware intermediary.
Yeah,
Yes, it is.
intermediary. Yep. Thank
Can
you.
you ping?
You're fast.
Can you ping that in the chat, just the section title or something?
Yeah, I can do
And for new people, we're not supposed to show the PCI spec in this meeting, but we can reference sections in it all we want. The PCI SIG hardly approves of us referring to the spec.
that. Yeah. 7.9.22 SFI extended capability is the first place I would go. There's another chapter, I forget which chapter, that talks about it a little bit more. But also look at 7.9.14.3. Actually not that one. I think it's the 6.2.2.1.
Yeah,
That talks about the error correctable SFW thing.
the question I would have though is when is hardware going to have the ability to distinguish between those corrected error messages?
Well, that was the problem, Mark, that the spec wasn't so clear. I'm not sure if any hardware actually did anything.
I'm not sure. I mean, in fact, I think I would be sure that nobody did. I'm not aware of any hardware that supports it,
Yeah.
but I guess that's it for something that's new. That's not a huge surprise, but I guess, my question would be when. I mean,
Well, so let's talk about hardware a little bit more. The I think some switches actually did implement the DPC SFI. So if you look at the DPC chapter, it's probably 7.9.14. One of the control bits does talks about the SFW capability. So I assume because that some switches did, some hardware did. But then on the other side is the root ports that need to respond to it.
Yes, that's
And
what I. So if root port does not reroute those signals to a different vector, right?
Yep.
Then then it's not a big, it's not a, it's a half big solution then, like we can't really make use of it. And unfortunately, that's what our experience so far. So, but this is a good call out, and maybe through this initially, right, we need to kind of amplify that, especially once we come to a conclusion that we need this capability to be enabled for a better solution. Then that would be a very useful outcome of this discussion. The good thing is, you know, the lead vendors are here, right? I mean, Intel and AMD, and I think we don't have anybody from ARM, and we want to make sure that ARM guys are also aware of it and start thinking about it. We don't have anybody from ARM here, right?
Not today. I don't think we generally do, but we have usually what ARM wants is for us to work with their partners, their ecosystem, like NVIDIA or Ampere. There's someone that builds ARM processors or uses ARM products.
Good. Okay. So, anybody from NVIDIA here? No, right?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, so yeah, I think I remember, fortunately, last time we did this, it's been a while, and then there's also a spring break vacation in between, so I remember we did call that out because we're starting, remember, anything that required this, we're supposed to call it out. There's no DPC here, but let's after this meeting, I'll make sure we can track all the things that we saw that we want to potentially talk to the PCIe SIG about. The other one was some switches had its scoreboard, so that when it did DPC, it wouldn't cause a timeout on the root port. That was something that I think we were talking about whether we could get somebody in this group to talk to their PCIe SIG and drive the ECN for that.
Can we just capture, Erwin, these recommendations that we are deriving?
Yeah, that's why I said after this meeting, I'm going to go through these notes and add it somehow to this page
Okay.
to make sure we
Well,
get captured it. Yeah.
I think what we need to do to just make sure we follow the rules we were given is, we can say that we had a suggestion, but any further discussion of that needs to be in a separate meeting with people that we confirm are SIG members. It needs to be a, SIG driven discussion, right? Well, we can drive it, but as SIG members.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, from this forum, right, we need to just have one person take the lead and then.
Of each proposal. I'm totally aligned with you, Neil. I just want to make sure we follow the rules.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. So I think following the rules is like what we just did here. We just, that's all we say. We're not talking about the much more than that, hopefully.
And maybe what we can do is have some private write-ups that we share between SIG members. So
Yeah.
yeah, if we can get someone to start that write-up, then we can have the private discussions.
Can we, how would we do that? It wouldn't be through this, it would just be through individual,
Well,
like,
we can double check, but my understanding is that when you join the PCIe SIG, there is a SIG NDA. And you can share things under that NDA with other SIG members. That's kind of the terms of it. And
I see.
so we could hold a separate meeting that was a PCIe meeting of SIG members, but we'd want to keep SIG representatives involved. And it's under that NDA, and it's, we're just following the SIG process for starting an ECN, but maybe we run it by a bunch of people first.
Yeah.
And if someone that knows this process better than me, has concerns, speak up, because I'm only parroting back what I heard when we had the concern. And I may have misunderstood something.
Okay. So
I think you're not wrong, Drew, but I kind of like Anil's suggestion also to take one to have one person take the lead, and then discussions are natural and so easy within the PCI domain, PCI SIG domain.
absolutely.
The
I
reason
was
I'm
echoing.
saying it, yeah, the reason I'm saying it is because say three companies who are PCI SIG members start talking, and then there is questions about, oh, do we need multi-parties? NDA is here and not, and I think it's just better to let all this take place within PCI SIG, right?
Agreed. The SIG has terms for having discussions and has its own NDA, so we follow that process and we are
Okay.
okay.
Yeah.
And that's what I was advocating. But I was advocating someone write it up, and then we hold a discussion using the PCI SIG
Yeah,
NDA agreement with SIG
sure.
members.
Yeah.
Right. So that we don't spend all this time on that, is that we jump over to back to the fundamentals of like, okay, what is the behavior and what is the repair action recommendation type discussion? And I thought change it up a little bit, especially since Nita brought this up, replay number rollover and replay timer timeout. This is a really interesting one to talk about. And reason that it's interesting is that this one benefits from memory or history. So there, in other words, if you only see replay timer timeout, like you should never see a replay number rollover without seeing a replay timer timeout. Or I forget, it might be vice versa. But generally, you would also probably, there's two cases where you would either see a receiver error, bad TLP, bad DLP, preceding or at the same time with these errors, right? And if you don't, then it actually hints to other issues. Like your PHY could be completely clean, and then your endpoint, for whatever reason, is messing up and not acting. Like its own internal firmware is stuck, right? Then you would not see a receiver error, bad TLP, bad DLP, and you would just see these replay timer timeouts on the other end occur because it never saw ACK or NAT. And so that would point to that it would be the device that's probably bad.
I my ex this is Bill Hong. My experience has been that it's fairly arbitrary that you can get a replay event of either type with no other error if one of the many conditions that allows packets to be silently thrown away occurs.
Yep,
And there
yep.
are quite a few in the spec. So to me, it's not a differentiator at all. I do agree with the, if you don't get a timeout, but you get a rollover, that's a little funky. But
Yeah.
we've had hardware that didn't guarantee to report every error. So it's kind of in the noise. Again, not informative, just oh, yeah, that shouldn't happen, but it does.
Yeah, I think you're right that there's too many places where you can drop packets. I don't know if a lot of them go unnoticed. So maybe the opposite of saying it. If you do see these errors and you see this, right, then this error is a direct consequence, is likely a direct
Oh,
consequence of a bad PHY.
yeah. I just my view of the world is now that we've proven that implementations out there believe that the receiver error is an optional feature, that it is one way to detect a device or a port that is not reporting receiver error is to see the replay events or to see the received error correctable events without the primary error. Primary error between being one of the three received
Error, bad DLP, bad TLP. Because
Oh.
history should always appear on a link error, except if something else isn't implemented.
Can you say that again, Bill? Sorry, I didn't
Yeah.
quite follow it.
If it's a link error, and not some defect in the state machine, then receiver error, bad TLP, bad DLP all mean exactly the same thing, and they should always appear if it's a link, an issue between the receiver and the transmitter. Replay events, both the timeout and the rollover, will occur in a subset of those if the event happens in a burst. In other words, I tried it once, twice, three times, etc. And so it gives you a profile of the distribution of errors. So burst errors will show a lot of timeouts or sorry, rollovers. Individual noise won't because they'll happen in singlets and always recover. So my initial start was to ignore everything other than those three with regard to link errors and to take all other error types and say they're an indication that one of those three didn't get flagged in the correctable side. But the spec explicitly states that for historical reasons, receiver error implementation is optional. And it drives me crazy because I've now had two different vendors stand on that position and sell me hardware that won't report a receiver error.
Yeah, that's
That sucks.
Yeah,
Honestly.
that's right.
One of them even has an internal counter that counts them. So it's like it's not that they didn't do the hardware, they just didn't want to report correctable errors.
I see. But bad DLP, bad TLP should not be optional, right?
Right.
That's,
And
yeah,
but
okay.
their difference between them is what kind of packet was going by when I flipped the bit.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, and it can be neither. And then receiver error has a bucket load of stuff that isn't really link errors, where they're basically a catch-all for some of the protocol mismatch, handshake mismatch stuff. Unfortunate that they're bundled in there because those aren't link events, but
Yeah.
receive error has a bunch of things having to do with framing that really aren't link errors.
So on those errors, if it's not the non-link errors, I've seen them too, but I never saw them like they wouldn't happen randomly, or they wouldn't happen on an ongoing basis. Or did you see that happen on ongoing like a typical receiver bit flip? That's a link PHY issue that you expect to see every once in a while.
Usually, if there's not enough margin, they'll have occur at a slow rate. But most of
Yeah.
our designs that don't have poor margin, I mean, the nominal machine never sees a correctable error. And so the ones that even see one, you kind of go, huh, wonder what's going on. We do have a slightly higher threshold, but when they start coming in, it's usually a connector type of thing. So it's small impedance mismatch takes the margin past where it should be. So they're always intermittent. They're almost never solid. If it's a solid error, you tend to get a link width mismatch or a link speed mismatch because we check that as well. And
Yeah.
that's very solid for saying, okay, the link was bad enough to go through recovery and come out at a lesser capability. Those are stuck bits, stuck pins, if you will.
So here I was, yeah. So on okay, I was gonna go back to this. So on this comment, right? I was saying it that threw away what I was saying was that because now if it I was originally saying that if you see receiver bad DLP bad TLP, then these replay errors are they're side effects. But because of what Bill just said, and thanks for reminding us that that receiver error is optional, and actually people I didn't know anybody treat it as optional. Then you actually don't know what He
Because
can't
of the
infer anything
silent,
anymore.
right, the normal silent dropping of packets. There's cases in which it says you can drop the packet under these conditions, but it says not to set the error bit. And those are, as a collection, rare and unusual, but they cause that case where you'll see the replay timeout. Basically, replay timeout is the one time had a glitch. The replay rollover says back to back had errors, and it's rarer to see the rollover because you basically have to have a burst of errors. So the signaling was bad enough for a period of time that it actually had to jump over and go through recovery.
And that was the other discussion that I think Nito was bringing up. So if you do get a bunch of replay number rollovers, and so the whole thing I was originally going to say was that about memory and history. So if you did see a whole bunch of replay number rollovers, and I mean a lot, and then you suddenly saw a completion timeout error, then you would not, you wouldn't, you know, right now completion timeout error we're saying was, you know, this is a repair action, all that kind of stuff. But if you saw a whole bunch of replay number rollovers, and then you end up seeing a completion timeout, it's because of this replay number rollover. Use this philosophy, use the recur action on this guy and ignore this one. And then
sorry, Arvin, I'm not following you. I thought that if there is a, so when replay number rollover means there is a ERC error, message came back, and then the transmitter is retrying that particular TLP or the set of TLPs. So in that case, if there's a non-posted transaction, that the timer will reset though, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, if the timer reset, then it will never expire.
Yeah.
The timer
I've never
starts.
Seen CTO. If CTO comes from correctable errors, something's wrong.
Yeah. So I don't think that's a valid statement that there are too many rollovers and CTO may fire. That correlation is not correct.
I can reproduce that. Without a surprise link down?
Without a surprise link down.
Wow.
So, well, because the CTO is a non-posted transaction, right? So...
Actually, one second. If there's a hierarchy, Let's say CPU root port and a switch and an end device. And if you're seeing replay number rollover, let's say between the switch and the device, and non-posted transaction started from CPU root port, let's say memory read, I can see how that can result. Now, in that case, your CTO value has to be very, very low.
or the replay number happen, it's so bad that it keeps happening over.
No, it
and
can't
over
be right. By protocol, it's only 2 bits. It's only two rollover. Sorry, third rollover results into timer timeout. Retraining.
Yeah.
Right. So and the retraining also there's a very tight timing. If you, I think within 5 milliseconds, if link doesn't come back, it's going to link down.
But this isn't link issue. This isn't link up or link down issue. Maybe we should talk about this. So replay timer timeout occurs. It has nothing to do with posted or non-posted, but you send a transaction out and you're supposed to get an ACK-NACK back. If you did not get an ACK-NACK back, then you're going to set this bit here. And you're gonna resend your TLP.
And what is the timer value there? I think the spec calls out it's less than 5 milliseconds.
I don't remember what it is, but yeah, it's a very small number.
Right. Okay. So let's say timeout happens, and then
you replay, and then you still timeout again. And if you, I think it was three, I forget.
Three.
Yeah.
Yeah. Three's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If you do this 3 times and you didn't get an ACK back, then you get replay number rollover.
I think you can also increase that counter if it's a NAC. And I think that's an optional thing to increase the counter if it's a NAC, but the spec has just left that open.
Which counter?
Shouldn't have to
rollover
replay,
counter. right? But it shouldn't be a replay timer anymore. If you get the ACK, it's no longer on the timer, so you kind of reset. But if you were
The
getting a
knack.
continuous iteration of replay timeouts alternating with a NAC, those could go on forever, right?
Yes.
Because it has to be three replay timeouts in a row to get to the rollover. But the
It
rollover is
could.
going to do a certain amount of link training. And I think at that point, if you don't come back, you're going surprise link down. So you'd have to have your CTO right around three times the replay timeout, which would be way too low for a CTO.
Well, so
Unless
on
it's
a
truly
retraining,
robotic, like the
on
other
a re
thing.
are you saying on a retraining the CTO timer gets reset? I don't think it gets
No,
reset.
I'm saying if you're getting this, making no forward progress, and you go to do the link retraining and you're still getting no forward progress, it should have ended in link down.
Yeah.
Right? It shouldn't have been able to do the negotiation.
That's right. And every time
Oh,
there's a NAC or
that's
REC
right.
comes back.
Theoretically, that's true. That's right. Yeah.
But the scenario that I was giving, right, where there's a hierarchy of the devices, root board and switch and a device, then I can see a scenario where if let's say this replay is repeatedly occurring on the link between the switch and the device. But the transaction that started was from the CPU root port as a non-posted.
Yeah, but the
Then
only way for it to extend larger than the CTO timeout is there be three consecutive timeouts, or, and that number is big enough to trip it, plus whatever the round trip through the switch is, right? So that does inflate it a bit, but it doesn't multiply it, right? It just inflates it.
Yeah, the
And
timer value
the
has, yeah.
possibility that if you keep doing the timeout and then get a NAC, you could still make no forward progress, but you wouldn't iterate through to the rollover. And that's one case that would be really, I'd love to see that. I've never seen one like that, but that would be unique.
Yeah, I think I'd retest, see this again, because I do have a test case that can cause this to occur, cause this as in, I can end up getting a CTO. And I thought, Mita, you saw the same thing, that you saw a bunch of replay number rollovers and then a CTO.
Highly suspected. Highly suspected that that's the case. I mean, we didn't have full set of logs, and what we were suspecting is that we were getting continuous timeouts as well as rollovers, and what we were suspecting is that the way it's happening is it's a series of NAC plus timeout, then NAC plus timeout that just continuously leads to the rollovers to continue happening even though the two sides, the switch and the endpoint below it, are, having something like the NAC is coming.
So Mita, in that case, the root port was timing out. You said you didn't see
So
any timeout.
it is highly suspected. We just didn't have the logs to prove it because we had like the symptoms that where we would have had a seen a completion timeout. We did get an unexpected completion, that one's for sure, but we didn't have the logs to say for sure that we had a completion timeout.
So, Arvind, the experiment that you were referring to, yeah, please take a look at it and share some more learning.
Yeah, I think it depends on how the way I was injecting it. We were messing with the state machine on the endpoint card, and so it might have been able to retrain, like we were talking about, and yet still after retrained, still not being able to make forward progress.
But that sounds like a chip logic issue more
It
than a
is,
link issue. Okay. Yeah, I would
yeah.
absolutely believe that because most of our CTOs are firmware bugs where the response is delayed, and that can be arbitrarily long delays, and that's where we get the CTOs. Anytime that leads to a surprise link down, you have a chance of seeing then a completion, unexpected completion, because what happens is you just time out, get the CTO, and then the guy finally answers. And then you throw that one away as an unexpected. So these things mess each other up when it's caused by firmware or hardware on the end device.
So, Bill, what you're saying is the like an unexpected completion coming in can in some cases results in us not seeing the completion timeout, because that's what we were suspecting, but
Turn it the other way is if I get a completion timeout that was just marginally missing,
yeah,
then I get the completion later. And what's he going to do with that? That's an unexpected completion. So
if
they sometimes come in pairs.
Mm-hmm.
If it is
but
other way
sometimes,
around, yeah, if it's other way around, then you will not see CTO.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the fact is, you can't really tell ordering because they happen too fast. In other words, both bits will be set in the SMI handler's time frame, right? So you don't generally see one, then the other. You see them all come together. And that pairing usually, it has to be the CTO first, is what Anil was saying, because that way you can then explain the unexpected completion is really the handshake that you missed the first time.
Yep.
Yeah, one very misconception that I hear quite often is that if a completion timeout happens, sorry, if a link goes down, then that could result into completion timeout upstream. And the answer is no. Because if the link goes down, then all the outstanding transactions, whatever were pending, will get completed with either UR or CA, and therefore will never time out.
Well, wait, are you
think,
talking about
yeah,
the disability?
Erwin
thing?
Had an example just
yeah.
for that, I think.
Yeah, if the timing
yeah.
of one guy giving up versus the CTO giving up, you can have the link go down just after or just before the CTO trip. So it's possible that they're asynchronous enough. And then the message has to flow for one end to notify the other that they can both occur. And the same event is really the key. They're not separate, you know, distinct events. It's just one guy's raising an alert at a timeout value arbitrarily different from the timeout or the series of events happening down where the link goes down.
Yeah, that CTO is actually in the spec happening. If you DPC, link goes down in the middle.
Yeah, that's exactly the point. If the DPC is enabled, link will always go down if there's uncorrected error. Yes.
Yeah.
But those will never turn into CTO.
No, that we're saying it can, and that was
no, it cannot.
That was what
I think
one of
he's
the,
talking about that switch scoreboard scenario that he discussed. So there is a possibility of that scenario also. But,
okay. That's a different thing. That's
yeah.
that's pending transactions after
mm-hmm.
that, right?
So, hey, Anil, you wanted 15 minutes. I just wanted to remind everyone. Anil wanted to talk about the presentations or talks he's proposing to make at the regional conference. OCP, what is it called? Regional Summit, right? Regional Summit.
Yeah, Regional Summit, yeah.
So, Anil, Erwin, whenever there's a good point for you to stop and give it to Anil, it would be nice.
Yeah, I think that might be a good place, because the whole thing I was trying to say was that errors can be linked to each other. And the other obvious one is if you see unexpected completion without a CTO, then somebody misrouted something or somebody's logic is really, really bad. But usually you see these as pairs, right? And so if you saw CTO, then you can ignore, especially if you have the head logs, you'll be actually be able to mesh the tags together between the header logs for the UC unexpected completion and the header logs for the completion timeout and the RPPIO registers. Okay. So, all right. Yeah, I think it's a good place to stop then afterwards.
All right. Let me share my screen. Okay. All right. Can you see what I'm sharing? Can you see?
Yep.
Yeah, so this is the topic that we will be presenting at the OCP Regional Summit, PCI Express error handling considerations in our AIML training cluster design. So we kind of frame the problem statement by saying, you know, these are the large clusters, lots of machines synchronously connected together. And if you look at just one rack among hundreds of racks, each rack contains two machines, or two what we call Grand Teton machines. Grand Teton is already published in the public. So this is and this is example running a Llama 3 training models on these machines. So if I zoom in into just one machine, then it really built on a pretty deep hierarchy of PCI devices. So we call like three different trays, the CPU tray, and then IO tray, and then GPU tray. And the interconnect is all through the PCIe interfaces. So lots of PCIe interfaces, lots of PCIe devices. Therefore, we have to really worry about making sure that the design is robust, error handling is good, we are able to catch all the errors, and wherever we can recover, we need to recover and prevent any kind of interruptions. So just looking into one hierarchy, you know, in this example, there are a bunch of devices shows up. You do just a simple LSPCI. So a large PCI device hierarchy results into increased PCI correctable errors, and therefore solution to handle correctable errors is important. And this is going to be the focus of our discussion. So correctable errors, I mean, we were just looking at that, right? Typically bit errors, bit flips, like receive error, bad TLP, bad DLP, repair timer, timeout. And the fault coverage really is, you know, first of all, reporting. You want to monitor all these errors. And if there's lots of errors happening, even though they're all correctable errors, we want to take some action because something weird is going on. And of course, by product, by the design, the link CRCD trial, link retraining recovery does happen. So generally, they are all correctable errors, should not result into machine link down or machine down unless the link is really bad. So the solution that we have or we had was based on what we call firmware first and SMI. So if you look in the middle here, every correctable error would trigger SMI. And SM handler will then save the log into persistent store in BMC, the cell log, and then notify to the kernel. And kernel just simply reports it, and that's about it. The real magic happens. Our tooling is constantly monitoring these cell logs. And anytime the number of logs or error rate, the error rate exceeds certain limit, we preemptively take an action because we don't want to wait till something really bad happen. We want to train the machine and take the machine down and do some reset and some remedy, some further repair action. So that solution typically works fine when simple machines, when we have only one or two PCI devices. But in these kind of complex machines, this is potentially leading us to having a lot of SMIs, and especially some of the link margins and all that, some design issues that we encountered with other vendors. We are experiencing a lot of SMIs. So we had to come up with a different solution than using SMI. So the new solution.
Can you just say what's SCI? Because I can't remember what it is.
System control interrupt, I believe.
Correctable.
Correct. Say again?
Corrected interrupt, right, Arvin? Is it corrected, right?
I don't remember the acronym. It's good. Interrupted EOS is how I just remember it.
Yeah.
I think it's for corrected. Yeah,
but that's a good call out, by the way. I'll
It's not corrected error. That's the method that the SMI code uses to signal the OS.
Some sort of control interrupt, but I'll take a look at it and then put a footnote here. Good question. Actually, let me pause here. Any question on this?
So, isn't the path to the SCL kind of slow?
We use IPMI syntax, and it's slow in a sense that we are able to save it. I think the question really is that how much time the SM takes. And we try to minimize that, and we stay within 50 milliseconds. So within 50 milliseconds, we are able to log it and exit.
Is there a handshake with the BMC?
No.
Did you say 50 milliseconds?
We try to stay within that.
That's 50 milliseconds on all the cores, though, right? Isn't that a lot?
That's pretty huge. Yeah, that's kind of where I was going, Anil, is I can see why you don't like SMM. You know, I mean, like when we do it, we target 1 millisecond.
Right. Yeah, yeah. We wouldn't, you know, we couldn't tolerate more than one.
Yeah, I'm saying upper bound is 50 milliseconds. We try to stay within 10 milliseconds. I don't want to say too many things, right? But 1 millisecond, not possible for us. I have not seen it. 3 milliseconds, yes. And we got to 3 milliseconds. 1 millisecond, I have not seen yet. Occasionally, we might see it, but not in a consistent way. If you are able to achieve 1 millisecond, that's awesome, Mark. I don't know how you're able to do that.
It's doable. We do it too. So
yeah, the scary part is, though, Anil, is, and obviously you have your own OS, but you know the problem is if you stay in SMI longer than a millisecond, you potentially do damage to the OS context. And that's the reason why, you know, there are very strict requirements for SMI.
I see. Yeah, I mean, we haven't really optimized it to that level yet. But now, since you said it, I'll take a look at it if there's a way to further optimize it.
So, Anil, I gave you a hint when I asked why you really can write the SCL that fast. So, anyway, I was just saying, well, and the reason I'm asking it is not just to say, oh, your SMMs take too long. It's like that's part of the scaling problem, right? That the longer the SMM takes, then it's kind of a avalanche of SMMs when you have a whole bunch of PCIe cards that can signal in near proximity to each other.
Yes, so that's a risk that we had, right? And we need to solve it. So this is I'm talking about the solution that we started with, which we learned very quickly that this is not going to work, right?
Right. So in our view, this wouldn't work, right? The idea is, and I think I've said this in here before, but you know, anytime you have a corrected error source, you know, it has to be manageable in order to generate SMIs. So the idea is that, you know, and I don't care what the source is, that, I mean, it can be PCI Express or anything else. If it's corrected events, it has to be manageable. And the idea is by manageable, I mean, I have a count, a threshold, so I can generate an SMI when I know I have actions to take. And the idea is this is, you know, the perfect implementation for that kind of thing. You know, you really need to have events that are counted threshold and then ultimately generate an SMI when you know you have work to go do, not on every corrected error.
Yeah.
And I know Anil wants to get to the other handler. I'm with you, Mark, but another question I have is, how can you read PCIe in the SMM handler at all? Because when we go do config reads and writes, it takes an eternity. And so you can't even really walk the hierarchy. It's like you do one or two accesses and you've blown your budget.
I think that's exactly what I was saying, that we have not seen finishing SM handler within a millisecond.
So PCI accesses just don't work in my experiences, are too slow. But okay, so that helps me explain. I understand where you're coming from now, and I'm so sorry. I don't mean to hold you up. I just wanted to try to understand what you meant by the problem. So if it, you know, it might help your slide to call some of that out, saying PCI accesses are horribly slow, you know, this takes too long, we're holding the OS off, we're going to, you know, create an unpredictable situation. It's not even application stall, it is that the OS can get in a unexpected state.
Well, so in reality, we don't see that kind of issue
Okay.
Most of the time, and there's some workload that we started seeing, but that also we ruled it out. So we don't see a lot of cases, but it is a nuance. I agree with that. There's a lot of nuance for every customer doing SMI. And it's a matter of time. I mean, we may start seeing something as we start scaling this these machines and deploying for a longer time, and some degradation happens, and we start seeing a lot more error than we normally see today.
So I was looking at this. It doesn't seem like I think I might have misread the same way that Drew was misreading this. The SMM handler doesn't. It only logs that it saw a CE. It doesn't go and read all the PCI Express registers, right?
It does. I mean,
not all. It goes to the root ports and figures out which ones had something, and then it follows the tree of the ones that had something.
But if there was multiple correctable errors that occurred, and you had a switch, that's a ton of devices. And a ton of registers
but the error source pointer will tell us where to go and read.
Not when you have multiple correctable errors. In that case, you have to take the worst case scenario and read every single device.
So that's a good point. When there's a multi-bit error happen, then it takes a little longer time. That's right. And we do have to scan through all the devices within that root port. Not everybody, but within the root port. Yes, you're right.
Yeah. And that's not what I was saying. That's what I meant by that would take a really, really long time, because that's a lot of devices.
Yeah. So we are optimizing it. We have already brought it. I would say within our target is 15 milliseconds. I've seen up to 10 milliseconds, but not less than that, because it takes some time to read the CSRs and all that. But anyway, so that's a problem statement, right?
Risk Wait, of I increase. Want... Just ask a dumb question. Maybe I did. So, sorry. And this is probably something that I'm missing in my knowledge. But why are we doing SMIs for correctable errors? You know, why can't they just be handled without firmware first mode? Maybe that's what I'm not quite getting.
Yeah. So I think maybe I should clarify. So our philosophy, and maybe Bill can tell a lot more because he has a lot more knowledge here. Our philosophy is to do preemptive maintenance. And what that means is, even though they're correctable errors, but we want to monitor them and keep track of it and do some error rate based checks. And if we see an error rate exceeding, then we want to take some preemptive.
Yeah, but also, Neil, if we ever get to the next page, I think we'll start hitting. The fact is that PCI architected error handling did not give a simple way to say, send my correctables this way, send my uncorrectables that way. That was robust, because we definitely want the uncorrectable errors logged off the host to the BMC, because the machine's going down so fast that they don't get logged by the OS. So that's the driver for using SMI. As soon as we come up with a viable and robust way to have the correctable errors go through a different path, so only one core is slow, then we're going to do it. And that's really what's going on here.
Exactly. So that brings to the solution space. So how do we solve? Actually, that's a good point, Bill. I may want to call that out somehow, that the driving force to do SMI here is because we have to use the same solution for uncorrected also, because that's how the spec is defined. I mean, that's how the implementation is being available in the industry, and we have to adapt to that. And because uncorrected are based on SMI, therefore correctable error also, we are forced to do SMI. Now, Mark made a very good point. If we do some thresholding based method, then we can minimize the impact. But the point is, we still have SMI, and we want to avoid that. Okay.
Well, so, we specifically don't want to have a silent, non-reported series of errors that don't hit threshold, right? What we're trying to do is have, at a higher level fleet-wide, a view of every correctable error that's occurring, so that we can get ahead of when they are increasing in rate, or when they're, you know, occurring on multiple devices that would indicate a power problem or a connector problem. So we're using every event as input to our analysis of what to go fix. So even if we were to do some sort of a thresholding thing, we'd report every error and record it with a timestamp, and then we would reduce it down to figuring out what our threshold is. And that's how our software works today.
Right.
And I think your analysis sounds amazing. I'm like, Scott, I'm amazed that you're logging that it works, but I'm impressed. So, you know, and I guess my dream personally, Bill, is that we could find a way to, you know, take some of these learnings and get the same logs without having to out of band and in band, without bogging, you know, everyone down with the logging, so that we can do that kind of analysis. It sounds very exciting.
And this is a step in that direction, because we've got a non-functional but good for experimentation implementation that does all of the same information gathering from AER records at the OS level. The problem is it only works if the OS stays up. So we don't have that turned on, but we have that flexibility. And the key here is to come up with a way to separate the correctables from the uncorrectables.
Yep. Yeah. So the solution space that we have implemented now is, first thing is, we don't trigger SMI for correctable errors, and we reroute correctable errors as MSI. And through the kernel AER handler, we send notification to RAS daemon. So we basically have loaded RAS, installed RAS daemon. And using RAS daemon is what is then saving it to BMC cell log. Now, why we are doing that? Because we still want to maintain the same tooling flow that we that exists today, because changing the tooling in our infrastructure is another complexity, and we wanted to design a solution where we don't have to rock the whole boat.
You can think of it as a migration strategy, right? We're going to do it so it's the same at the edge of the box, logged in the same places, logged with the same syntax. And then once we have it all robust and working, we'll cover it over to doing the correctable error gathering in the OS and get rid of that, you know, the RAS daemon poke in the cell. But all of this is that, because it's MSI, only one core is stalling out. So we're going to do all the same slow, pokey stuff, but it'll only be hurting one core.
Correct. Yeah. So that eliminates the burden of this SMI. We are still good for uncorrectable errors. We will still follow the same method of SMI, which we are showing here. But for correctable error handling solution, is now based on this MSI and a RAS daemon. And we modified the RAS daemon, did an upstream the patch already to send this IPMI command to log this event into BMC cell. And then that's the tooling just works the way it is. So that's a solution that we have developed, and we start deploying it. So far, we are seeing good results in terms of we don't see any latency kind of impact that we were sometimes observing it, and the burden of SMI is not there anymore.
So, hey, Anil, we are a little bit over, but I have a fundamental question. Was it plan of migration because of the nature of SMM altogether, or was the Grand Teton or AI deployment drove the requirement differently?
I'm not sure I understand the question. You mean SMI solution?
What was the motivation for changing this solution now?
We were motivated to get rid of SMIs many generations ago. We just weren't motivated enough to go do all the work. I think it became a more urgent problem because of the number of PCI endpoints that were having errors.
Right. And also a clean solution that we can implement reliably was not that easy. And yeah, thanks to our CPU vendors, I'll just leave it there, that they provided us some logic.
Some of the capabilities only came in the most recent Linux versions too. So there were things emerging in the technology implementations from the componentry we need to assemble that wouldn't have allowed this to happen 3 years ago.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, and Neil, this looks like, you know, I showed you the in-band AER driver that we're trying to build to gather telemetry. So maybe as we continue working on it, it's something we can share with. I mean, we want to upstream this AER stuff for in the kernel for everyone. I would love to talk with you as we make a little progress to see if we could integrate it as a proof of concept into RAS daemon, because what we're trying to do is get binary, rigorous binary error logs from PCIe instead of you know, writing some string to demessage and, you know, praying we can regular expression parse it.
Yep, yep. So just, Yogesh, if you give me a couple of more minutes. So that good point, Drew, that leads to the next step, right? So one of the very key thing that we are driving now is developing an ECR, a PCI Express firmware specific ECR, to revise the firmware OS interface implementation. What we did so far, actually, in some sense, is I would say a kludgy solution, workaround kind of thing, but we want to do it more systematically, spec-based implementation. So that'll require a change in spec. So we are working on right now to develop the CCR. And as a result of that, there will be some changes required in AER handler also. And Drew, that's where I think let's talk more.
I was going to say, can we have a PCIe, you know, SIG meeting between us to align our driver work with wherever you're headed?
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, I already started with some vendors, but let me just bring you into the loop. And
okay, and what we're going to do, you know, just for everyone's benefit, what we're going to do at Google is, you know, we're going to continue to come back here with our driver proposals, and you know, we're upstreaming them. So you know, what we're doing is not SIG specific; it's Linux kernel changes. So we'll keep coming back here with our proposals as well, just to keep you on the loop. And you know, but it's upstream. We're not trying to do anything special or hidden. We want binary error logs that you can subscribe to in a known format.
Perfect. So that's the second part, right? So work with the ecosystem players to implement the changes in the platform firmware, the Linux OSPM, and AER driver, right?
Yeah.
And then contribute this requirement to the OCP sub-project, which is sort of indirectly, we already did that, but we'll make it more explicit requirements here. And that's about it.
So I wanted to throw in one, since you were poking at how we report to the OS. One of the issues we have, because there's the whole SysFS structure for AER logging, and it's great and wonderful, and every time we try and use it, we end up keeling over and dying. But there's two major flaws. One is we really want the timestamp for each event. And one reason we write to the cell, even in this transitional period where we're going to handle it through less disruptive means and then still write cells, it gives us the timestamp. And by going through the SMI handler, it's really close to the real time of the event, much more so than any other reporting mechanism we've got. And the SysFS structure just logs a count. You have no way to put a timestamp on it. Even if you tried to subscribe to the flow, you're not sure the latency from event to you.
Yeah.
But the other problem is SysFS structure isn't really good at knowing when to refresh its caching. And so we found it hard to trust what's in there relative to devices failing and going off the bus. So that whole structure has been overly fragile, unfortunately.
Can we find the SysFS? Because there's the AER SysFS, and then there's ftrace, which is what RasDaemon does. And there should be a timestamp.
We're moving to RasDaemon for a bunch of reasons. I was saying the legacy AER SysFS structures.
We
implemented a bunch of stuff, and then it didn't deliver reliably, and so we sort of left it.
Right. So I didn't tell that part of the story. So we did look at the REST SysFS also, and as Bill was mentioning, right, for various reasons, we chose not to use SysFS because somebody could ask question, why did we use RasDaemon? SysFS could already give us the error count, right? And we can compute our rate, but as Bill mentioned, it's not very effective for us.
So I need to drop, but Anil, we really need to talk because we are starting work on the driver shortly, and you know, if we could get learnings from you, it might influence how we implement the driver in your favor and ours. So
sure.
Let me
include you in the email thread that we already have it going right now, and then let's.
Sure. I would also like to have a kind of a PCIe SIG kind of review of, you know, like a SIG NDA between our companies since we're both members and have a discussion that we can't have here.
Yep, absolutely. Let's do
And
that.
I'll just one last note. We do want to continue working on in-band requirements in our requirements document. I know we are totally switched to PCIe right now.
Yes.
We don't want to ignore that.
Well, and, we have not forgotten you, Anil. We know you want to do it, and we are for it. We're not holding you back.
Sure. Yeah. Cool. That's it. No, we are 12 minutes past. Thank you.
This is awesome.
That is good.
Yeah.
It was really good.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing that, Anil.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Have a good weekend, everyone. We'll talk to you guys next time.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.